sign up sheet. For anybody who wants to speak tonight, you kind of divided out the categories into Cityhood, Board Against, County Consolidation, Board Against, and then our current model of having Board of Commissioners, keeping it or changing it. So if you haven't already signed up, if you're interested in speaking tonight, please let me know, and we'll get started here. So, Mike Dudgeon here. We're going to be kind of high-tech tonight, try to get some immediate feedback. We're going to have some polling going on with your smartphones and texting, so I'll turn the mic on.
All righty. Hopefully y'all can read that. The part you really can't read is the number you're texting to. So this is a sort of sample question. And y'all, it says, how did you learn about this town hall meeting? And you're texting to 22333. So that's two twos and 333. Three threes. And what you're going to text to that number is one of the other four numbers, depending on what your answer is. So for example, if you heard about this meeting through Facebook, you would text 872-513 to 22333. And somebody figured it out because we got a number up on the screen. And the cool part about this technology is as it's done, it real-time updates the results. And so it's kind of a cool way to get feedback immediately about issues. So this is, y'all are figuring it out. And it means, I guess, most of you can read it, so thanks.
All right, thank you for being the Dudgeon. Also, I want to thank all of you for coming out tonight. I know it's kind of cold out there and a lot better place we can be than in here, but thank you. And before we get started, I just want to kind of turn our hearts to our God and our country. I'll lead us in prayer, followed by the pledge. So, our Father in heaven, thank you for this day that's given us with this beautiful weather. Thank you for this time of year where we're able to see the colors change on the trees and then the beauty that's around us. Thank you for this time we have to gather together as a community to discuss those things that are near and dear to our hearts. Thank you for our leaders here in the community as well, both our religious leaders as well as our civic leaders. Thank you for this country that we live in, for those that have offered up their lives and sacrificed for our freedoms and our liberties. Thank you also for our Savior Jesus Christ and for his sacrifice for us. Please help thy Spirit be with us and lead us and guide us in this discussion. Please help us to open our eyes and our ears and to kind of remove any bias that we might have and be able to listen to the merits of each case that's presented before us. Again, we ask for thy guidance in this meeting and say these things in Jesus Christ. Amen. I suppose you can stand.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Anybody else? All right, thank you guys for coming out. I also want to thank Principal Gordy for allowing us to have this meeting here. And also the staff for letting us set up and wanting to listen as well. Tom Levin has asked me to let everybody know that he is not here right now, but he's on his way. He has a planning meeting about a neighborhood and with Mullinax and a red light and all kinds of stuff like that. So he should be here shortly. So he just wanted me to pass that message along to everybody. So he should be here shortly. The purpose of this meeting tonight, this is the third and final of three. Both Representative Duncan and Dudgeon have already had one, and we just want to talk about, or actually we want to listen to what you guys have to say as far as it comes to the county governance. It's not our role tonight to kind of inject our personal beliefs or feelings. This meeting is for each and every one of you, the constituents here in Cumming County. So to that end, we want to limit the amount of comments from us, the elected officials, including the Board of Commissioners. If you guys have questions for us specifically, I know we're very approachable. Please feel free to give us a call, email us, or talk to us after the meeting and whatnot. If there are any elected officials here that want to speak, any commissioners, we want to start by giving you guys 5 minutes if y'all would like to speak. Commissioner Boff, do you have anything to say? Commissioner Amos?
No, thank you.
All right, thank you. So the rest of the meeting then is up to you guys. Now, I also want to preface this meeting by saying the purpose of it isn't because we feel like Forsyth County is a bad place to live or it's going down the tubes or anything like that. It's actually right the opposite. We believe very strongly that Forsyth County is a great place to live. We have some of the best school systems here in the state. Crime is really low, taxes are low. We just want to make sure that Forsyth County continues that trend. My background is business. And I think around about 15 or 20 businesses that 20, 30 years ago were the best businesses around. They talked, they had articles, books written about the processes, their visions, all that. They don't exist at all today. And we don't want that to happen in Forsyth County. So again, the purpose of this meeting is for us to share ideas, things that are going well, also things that we might want to improve upon. And we've kind of broken out the three different areas. What's that list? Has it circulated around yet? Three areas are, again, cityhood. Right now we only have one city here in Forsyth County. Do we need multiple cities? Also, consolidation of the city of Cumming with Forsyth County. And then lastly, the way we elect our board of commissioners. Are we happy with the way the model is set up? Or do we need to change it? We're going to give individuals that have signed up 5 minutes to speak. There's certain groups that if they need 7 minutes to speak, we're going to go ahead and allot that time as well because they haven't been battled with other invitations to show. Also, we like to keep this not personal. We don't want to make any personal attacks or anything like that. So let's be respectful to one another. Yes, sir.
Where do we sign up?
We have the list floating around right here. Steve Benefield. Where's Steve? Well, I'm going to turn time over to Steve. He's the first one to sign up, and he is with the Sharon Springs Alliance.
I apologize for the car, because I'm not a public speaker by any means, so I'm probably going to read a lot of what you hear. But I just want to thank everybody for coming out tonight. My preacher always said that the pretty people showed up when it's raining or cold, so y'all must be gorgeous because it's freezing. Thank you, Mike Williams, for hosting us tonight, and congratulations on your election. My name is Steve Benefield, and I am here representing the Sharon Springs Alliance. I am one of the founding members of the Sharon Springs Alliance and currently hold the office of Treasurer. The Sharon Springs Alliance is a nonprofit made up of private citizens like you who are studying the formation of a new city in South Forsyth. We are not developers, we are not politicians, we are just a group of parents concerned about the future of Forsyth County. Now, why would we consider the city? If I had one sound bite as to why we need a new city, it would be to protect what we have, what we are. Forsyth County is a fantastic place to live, and I plan on being here a long time. I want Forsyth County to remain a great place to live for the next 30 years. I feel that if we continue down the road of poorly planned development, if we continue down the road of treating our UDC like it's just a suggestion, the quality of life we now enjoy will quickly disappear. There are many reasons to consider Cityhood. Accountable government, long-term planning, and community identity. All of these reasons are on our website at SharonSpringsGeorgia.org. It's all backed up by supporting data. I encourage you to take advantage of the website. The study, you need to study what is there to educate yourself and to draw your own conclusions about Cityhood. Tonight, you may hear from those that oppose the very thought of Sharon Springs. They will say that your property taxes are going to go up. That is not necessarily true. They will say we are adding a layer of oppressive government. I think that perhaps we need a less oppressive local government. Today, I saw a poll in the Forsyth County News website that asking the question, should we have a new city? I think this is a little premature. What we are talking about, and I do mean talking, is about the feasibility of a new city, a city life. It is not time to vote yet. I came out to asking a jury to render a verdict, you know, before the case is presented. It's not time yet. So any kind of poll that you take right now is really senseless. That being said, all of the objections deserve discussion, and we welcome them. Our message is clear. Let's consider Cityhood. Now, on a personal note, it has been very difficult for all of our board members and volunteers. We have full-time jobs and families that demand our attention. Time is a precious commodity. Any time we devote to the Sharon Springs Alliance is time that we must take away from our families. Why do we do it? Because we feel that it's important, and we think that it's worth the sacrifice. The first step to Cityhood is to conduct a feasibility study. The feasibility study takes money, a lot. It takes donations. Now, it is one thing to post on Facebook or to do a website just to see how many likes you can get. It's quite another thing to have a message compelling enough that somebody is willing to give you their hard-earned money. To physically write a check or to donate via PayPal sends a powerful message. It says, yes, I believe in your call. I will tell you, it's very tiresome to ask people for money, but the response we have had has been absolutely fantastic. The response was so overwhelming that as the treasurer, I have the pleasure to announce tonight that the feasibility study is fully funded. 100% of the money has come from private donations from people just like me. Nothing corporate, it's businesses. The results of the study are anticipated in early March. In the meantime, the Sharon Springs Alliance will continue to focus on raising awareness for what Cityhood could offer our community. Thank you for your time.
Stephanie Raymond. All right. all, for those of you who have come out this evening to be a part of this discussion. I have to say that as a homeowner, it's been very encouraging to see so many people who have come and attended these town halls. And again, thank you to the representatives who have made these possible. I'm going to try to not bore the few of you who saw my earlier talk at the Lambert Town Hall. I am a supporter of the Sharon Springs Alliance. I'm a supporter of the Sharon Springs Alliance because I fear, much like what Mr. Williams said, that the past and the present are not indicative of our future if we don't take care of what we have. I love Forsyth County. I have two children. Neither of them are even in the school system yet. They're both under five. In 2011, we considered moving to Milton, but we stayed here because the schools are great, the taxes are low. There's a beautiful rural character about this place that we live. But I'm not from here, and I suspect a lot of you may not be from here either. I've lived and worked a lot of different places during my life. And I've seen that there are other ways this could be done differently, other models for development and growth. And I feel like we could be doing better for ourselves and for our children as we look to the future. Kind of like Steve said, you know, we have a plan, but we don't always follow it. You know, I look at some other communities and I hear about stories of other leaders in other areas, and they're very firm on setting restrictions and following those. And not only do we seem to lack a real defined plan and identity for that matter, but we also are not really, we don't really stick to the one that we have. Here are some of the concerns I hear from parents in my neighborhood. They've got kids with 40 in a math class. They all don't have a seat, and some of them have to share the teacher's desk. This is at South Forsyth, in order for them to be able to have a place during their class time. I have other friends who have children where they're being given candy constantly throughout the day as a reward system because mother is concerned that the teacher can't control the number of children in the classroom. Commutes have doubled in the last year. It can take 3 to 4 lights to go through an intersection at rush hour, right? I'm sure people have noticed this. And obviously we have a bond that's going to help take care of some of that. But that's not going to be the end of the bonds. There's no way that this growth is sustainable without additional taxes. So to the people who feel like looking at a new city is going to raise taxes, I would say, you know what? All of us are going to be paying more in taxes in order to, as a county, sustain what we have. I mean, the schools really are so important to our home values and our children. And I think people are very willing to make decisions to support those, and we're going to have to decide for more taxes to do that. I think, unfortunately, what I like to say is the manifestation of these issues really is the zoning approvals and the number of new homes that have come online. In addition to that, all of the zonings that happened between 2005 to 2008 that are just now being built out. I'm not sure that we've done a good job reconciling what's in the pipeline or could be in the pipeline with what we're now approving in terms of zonings. I guess to me, our actions indicate that we may not understand the value of our community because it seems like we could be asking more. So how can we change this trajectory of unplanned growth? Obviously, there's citizens groups working on this. The Sharon Springs Alliance is one of them. It's in the area where I live, and I'm a very strong supporter. I've been volunteering lots of hours each week, like Stephen said, giving up time with my kids in order to try to make something better for our future. Also, I know people are going to talk tonight probably about returning to countywide voting, consolidating the city and the county. You know, all of these things, you know, I think are part of the discussion and things that should be discussed. They may not be the answer, or they may be the answer for some group of people and not for another. For me, I think looking at Shared Springs Alliance is something that I feel like is not only viable and feasible economically, but it could potentially very much make sense for our community. I think I'm going to close now and let it go on to the next person, but thank you so much for your time, and again, thank you to the representatives for having us.
Tony DiMaria. Maria. Where's Tony?
You want to just do cities, or you want to do everything?
You have 5 minutes.
Okay.
I'm going to do cities first, city grid first, because very short and sweet. Assuming it's feasible, and assuming the people want it, and I believe you should give it a darn good try. I think it makes sense. Thank you. I think it makes sense from everything I've read, but we need to look at the numbers. And I applaud the people. And there's a lot that have worked on it, including the former speaker recently.
Hold your microphone up.
Okay. So I think that's number one. Number two, there's lots of people that are saying, well, let's get even with the city. They've been taking 12.5%, 15% of this, and we think, you know, the old boss hog just isn't with it anymore. And I think that we need to look at positive things. This is a good county, great county, and I think we don't need to start arguments or legal issues. And I know there's folks at the Dome and folks up here that are saying, look, we have big issues. The city's small, it's 5,000 people, 3% of the population. Let's not worry about that now. So my suggestion is, let's go after the big issues. And to me, the big single issue is countywide voting. That simple. In 2009, most people lost, they think they lost 80% of their votes, voting ballot, within Forsyth County. 4 out of 5 districts, you no longer can vote. So, does 80% loss sound about right to everybody? Raise your hand. Why? Take a look at just a simple example. We had a balance bar. Balance bar is developers here, homeowners here, somewhere in the middle, what's right for the county. And when we see the land use plan always being interpreted, whether it should be, because it says Reg 3 or Reg 2, 98% of the time, our BOC is interpreting in favor of the developers, the large landowners, and they're saying Res 3. And then what they do? They took 14.5 and bumped it down to what, 10, 11? So they just made it more dense. So why therefore countywide voting? Because we can vote for everyone. Now, here's a test, okay? What was the last countywide voting we had? Anybody know? Pardon? South Lake?
2008.
No. I say 2014. Stand up, Michael. Stand up, Evan. Come on, stand up. 64% of the people. 64% of the people say, hey, we don't want that old politician. No. Part of the old power structure. We want new people, young guys. He didn't want to be a politician. 2 terms, 3 terms, no more than 6 years. He's gone, and let's bring in somebody else. So, simply put, we have countywide voting. He proves it works. Let's go back to it again. And let's keep things simple. Finally, some talk about we should have be able to elect the chairman of the commission. And people will elect him for 4 years. So you're going to have to run. You want to be chairman of the commission? You have to run. Okay. Here's a problem with that. Who runs our county? Who are our pros? We got great professional people. Think about it. We really do. We have great county people who are highly professional. Are we going to elect some person that's part-time be a chairman? He's not going to be a chairman of what's right for the county. He's going to be a political chairman. We don't need a political chairman.
We need top-notch professionals. And one more minute and I'm finished. And let's have all our commissioners working together. A thought I had just the other day is rather than have them internally elect, like Pete was elected the other last January, before Pete was what? Jim Boff, before Jim was, why don't we just set term limits that you can be, just have a little law that says you want to be, no, it's a law. The next person in the barrel stays for 1 year. He's out, and then the next person's in. So we get everyone working together. So all these five people are working together because they know, hey, I'm out of the barrel next year. And so's it. I thought we need for them all to work together a little bit better than they do now. Thank you, sir.
We're going to put up a new survey.
I couldn't get there from my house anyway, so it wouldn't matter. when you do these kind of things, as long as you don't have hard feelings, it'll all work out in the end. That's all I got to say.
Successful organizations realize that there are some things that they can do and some things that they can't do well. And when you can't do something well, you bring in other people to do it. And so when organizations like Sharon Springs stand up and offer to take over development or planning in their area, in the boundaries that they set for their city, I think as a county we should give them the right to do it. Give them the opportunity to do it. And the reality is, the state constitution and the Georgia legislature have already created the vehicle to give them, or to allow them to do it. It's not necessarily whether we want them to do it or whether we allow them. They have the right to do it. So I really think we need to give it serious consideration. And what got me started looking at this is, as an accountant, I started looking at some of the information behind what's going on. And when I started looking at District 4 where I live, according to the 2010 census, I had 36,415 neighbors in 2010, right? If you look at the zoning applications that are approved but unbuilt, the county is planning to put 70,000 people in District 4. And if you look at the rate at which we are approving construction permits, that's going to happen in 5 years. We're issuing at least 3,300 construction permits a year. And that's up 20% over last year, right? Growth is coming. And it's really, in my opinion, not a question of whether it's good or bad. It's what are we gonna do? Because if you look at the four things that most people say that are good about our county, because we are a very successful county, they like our great schools, our low taxes, right? Quality of life, right? And predictable home values. But if you look at District 4, in 2010, we have roughly 9,000 students with a capacity for 10,000. If you look at the growth and where we're going, the Board of Education plan will add 4,000 more students in the next, or more seats for capacity in the next 4 years, right? But if you grow to 70,000, we're going to need capacity for 24,000 students. Where are the other 10,000 students going to go to school? And when you stand back and look at how education affects your property value, according to the Federal Reserve Bank of St. Louis, 37% of your property value is related to the quality of education in your community. And the relationship isn't arithmetic, it's logarithmic. In other words, when you have above average education, you have a high property value, that 37%. If your math scores drop by half a point, you lose 15% of that. And it's logarithmic, it reduces on a logarithmic scale from there. So education is important. Quality of life. I commute to Alpharetta every day. My times behind the wheel, behind the windshield, have doubled over the last 4 years, right? It's just a fact of life, but it doesn't have to be, right? 59% of the people that live in this county commute outside of the county for work. And most of us drive towards Atlanta. We're not working in the county, we're going somewhere else, right? We earn our incomes outside. If traffic and congestion impacts our quality of life, why aren't we doing more than simply adding $200 million in debt, right? It's more than that. And then if you stand back and take a look at affordable taxes, I mean, I'm an accountant, so I pull the public filings, you know, I crank numbers, it's just kind of what I do. But we've added $395 million in debt in the last 12 months. If you look at the last 4 years, we're spending $15 million more than we did 4 years ago. We were at $88 million, and now we're at $103 million on our operating expenses for the year. I mean, we're continually spending more money. Our property taxes will go up. So, and finally, if you, the last thing is predictable home values, right? And predictable home values relate back to everything else that I talked about. If you can't predict what's happening in your community, your home values will become unpredictable. And that largest asset for most of us will lose. So in closing, I'm getting the high sign here. I think if you really stand back and take a look at it, bring in people who are energetic and want to control growth or manage growth or let growth happen. Let those people do it. Because if you outsource it, like when you outsource at a business, you're sending expense out of the county and you're sending it to a city. A dollar out of the county, a dollar into the city. The expenses are neutral, right? And the revenue is pretty much neutral. So thank you for your time.
I hate to be going against the grain. First of all, my name is Paul Flood, and I live on Lake Lanier, and I have a company there. I'm a consultant that works with hospitals and hospital associations and physicians in strategic thinking and planning and setting goals and objectives. And my company, we work from Virginia to Texas to Florida, hospitals and so forth, and have for about 40 years. I grew up in southwest Atlanta in the West End Cascade Heights area, went to Marist and Georgia Tech, and moved up here. I bought a house with two other fellows on the lake for weekends and so forth in 1973. So I've been a property payer since 40 years. And then decided to live up here full time and built a house in 1993. So I've been a full time resident up here for 20 years. I've got a grandson that was the second string quarterback for West Forsyth High School right here and is considered to be the quarterback next year as a junior. And he's also a pitcher. He was on the varsity last year and plays on elite baseball teams and goes all over the Southeast. So I've got some strong roots here in Forsyth County. And I'm a believer that here, when you look at Greater Atlanta and how it's going to grow, Frank Norton over in Gainesville at a board meeting, also on the board at the Lake Lanier Association, and I'm on the advisory board down at Georgia Tech for the School of Systems and Industrial Engineering. And so I get involved in a lot of different things. And Frank said that the Greater Atlanta population is now 6.5 million, and by 2040 it'll be 12.5 million. And where are all those people gonna come? Where are they gonna settle? Well, a lot of them. Where is a better county in Greater Atlanta than Forsyth County? And so they're going to be coming, a lot of them are going to be coming up here. And so what we need to do, we need to be able to look at this county and say, where should the commercial enterprises be? Where are people going to set up businesses? Where should that be in the county? Where should the residential areas be, and how are we going to look at the total county and determine what the strategy ought to be and what should be best for the county in the long run? Because I've talked to a lot of people saying, well, golly, I moved up here because it was kind of a rural county, I got in a fight on the square when I was a junior in high school with a couple of folks, and I won't go in, a couple of boys, and it was like 15,000 people up here then. And look at how it's grown and how it's going to continue to grow. And so we need an organized total group, and we don't need to be splintered. We don't need to have a Cumming, and a Cumming ought to become part of the overall county. And maybe we need more county commissioners, and we need legislative people looking at what we're doing. But we need to determine what is best for the overall county and where things should be located and how we should grow in an intelligent and economic development. And so we need a one organization doing that, and with electing intelligent people and so forth in order to accomplish that. So my point is, and I won't go the full 5 minutes here, is to say that we need an organized group of county commissioners, and maybe the city ought to be consolidated into the county when the mayor retires. We're not going to do that until he retires, but when he does, to put it all together. So that's why I'm for having one organization that looks after the economic and best interest, cultural and environmental interest of the total county.
Where you know they say history repeats itself, Well, we're looking at it. It took an economic bust, the housing bubble, to get us back on an even keel, so to speak. And now we're trying to make up for lost time because of the years that we had the housing depression, if you will, by going right back to what we tried to fight against back in 98, 99, 2000, and that was a number of commissioners who just felt that the developers were the cat's pajamas and the codes were an inconvenience that they finally found that they could adjust. And I can tell you from practical experience, and I'm not the only one, that I don't think that where we're going right now, whether it's a city, I don't think that's the answer. That's just my opinion, only because you fragment things. I think that we have to deal with what we're having to deal with as far as the code is concerned, and what we're having to deal with as far as how the commissioners purport to be in your favor. But in the meantime, the code doesn't get the attention that it really needs to have. So just be aware that you need to be involved, and when you get to it, you need to go back to at-large voting. If you weren't in this county in 2009, and I think that's when it was probably voted on, okay? I don't think a lot of people really understood what they were voting for. And we're reaping the whirlwind of that very bad vote. So, little history, learn a little history about the county. And I think you'll find that you're gonna find a lot of similarities.
Michael?
Yes.
Before you go on, could you explain that? That's not affected by as much sense as the ballot question on district voting in 2000.
It says, do you think we should change in some way how Forsyth County is governed?
Yes.
So do you think we should change in some way how Forsyth County is governed?
How do you mean governed? District election? Multiple commissioners?
It's a very generic question. Basically, are you happy with the way it's Forsyth County being governed right now? If you are, then you know. If you're not, you yes. If you're still no, it's a very overall high question. All right, Don Oberlin.
I'm here. I didn't realize that I was signing. I don't have anything to say. I'm sorry.
Okay. And in the sake of everybody's time, I know the previous town hall meeting, if you had time for questions, we had quite a few more people signed up to speak, and maybe we'll be out here about an hour and a half. Not official, but there are four or five commissioners here tonight. There are four of the seven state delegation members are here tonight, as well as a board of education members. So we're all very accessible. If you have questions, also the people that are spoken, I'm sure they would love to talk as well about things that spoke about tonight. So if you have additional questions, feel free to talk to any one of us. It's going on. We move on to city county consolidation. First one is Geoff.
Thank you. My name is Jack Leeson. I live in South Forsyth County. I apologize for my dress tonight, although I'm actually very warm. I'm actually too warm now. I am a working man, despite what my wife and some of my friends will tell you, and I work today. So I want to get right to the point here. I moved here in 2002. I grew up, was raised in California, wasn't getting what I was paying for. I was looking for a place to raise my kids, a good environment for my lovely wife, and have them bring me along. My nephew was a whiz at demographics and computer research. He was living over in Cherokee County. Said, you need to check out Georgia. We did. We sold our house in 28 days and moved here. And everything was great, man. It was beautiful. My kids got through high school, and I have an autistic son. He got to graduate with a diploma. He was told it wasn't going to be, you know, probably not amount to much, and he's on taking to college. My daughter's in college. We live in a great society here, and there, it does have its problems. It's had its problems with growth, primarily for everybody else figuring out what I figured out 12 years ago. It's a great place to live. Low taxes, high quality of life, high level of service. It's a thing you don't hear a lot about. Level of service is really quality of life, quality of our roads, the response of our government to provide schools, to provide law enforcement services that lead us to have the quality of life that we have. The impediment that I've come to see is this us and them thing going on between the city and the county. Wonderful people working in the county government that I've been very involved in. I work with Smart Growth Forsyth as an environmental compliance officer. I'm on the Metropolitan North Georgia Water Planning District Board for my interest in water issues. And so I've come to glean a lot of information about our water situation. And that has a lot to do with the us and them problem between the county and the city. Several decades ago, the fathers of the county didn't want to see growth and development here. They saw the pressures of urbanization from the greater Atlanta area. They didn't want access to the lake. On the other hand, there was this big chicken plant downtown. They need 1 million gallons a day. The city was happy to give that to them. They got the keys to the water. And here we are today. You have a city of less than 6,000 people that control the water for nearly 250,000. And that's creating problems with the powers that be at the state and the federal level. Because when they look to give out these water storage allocations, they need, it's based on demand. They're looking over at us, and we're not this unified thing. So I'm a proponent of the county and the city merging together. Okay, I don't know how many square miles we are, 45 square miles, whatever square miles, we're not that big, really. And 200,000 people isn't that many people. I come from a state where there's 34 million people. There's only 52 counties. Georgia has 159 counties. You know, for a state that's jumping up and down about too much government, you guys got a lot of government there. To break it down further and fracture, I'm serious, to fracture it even further with another city. Now there's another argument about the division of SPLOST funds. The big impediment to this county being better than it already is today is we need to come together. We need to work together. We need to understand that we have different perspectives. We need to sit down in a room and understand this perspective. The people in the city are coming, some of those people have been here generations, 150 years back. Their families drive through. That's the kind of place I want to come and live with, okay? And then we have the county. We have bright, intelligent people, and we have new age businesses wanting to move to the county. We have the planning department, our comprehensive plan. The shortcoming there is, I think what they should do is they should look at where the environmentally sensitive parts of the county are, and that's where the least density needs to go. So, just to kind of wrap it up, I can appreciate that the Sharon Springs Alliance, I was there in 2008 when I read the $200 million green space and transportation bond. When I read between the lines, I thought, God, what are these guys going to do? Take everybody off in the south part of the county and have them split off like Sharon Springs and Milton? And then the more I looked into it, kind of like a bad colonoscopy, like the crappier it got, but the problem really is this divisiveness between the city and the county. We need to come together. Lord Gravick could retire. We need a 7-board member, district elections, and then 2 at-large, so there's a balance right there. There's something to be said when District 5, when everybody in the county can vote, you know, and District 5 gets somebody that they didn't necessarily want. So they have a valid argument. I think a 7-member board with 2 elected at-large would balance things out better. I think the city and the county merging would be a fabulous thing. The state and federal government would see that. Our water application could come together. We would only prosper. We would have much better communication. It's still going to grow. I think it would be much better to manage. Thank you.
Good morning. Good morning.
A second dish stop.
Okay.
All right.
Bob Ward.
Thank you. Good evening. I'm not sure how I got categorized in that category, so I'll just take a disclaimer on that about consolidation for now. But basically, we don't know what we don't know. And what I mean by that is, I think it behooves all of us to look and investigate things like Sharon Springs Alliance, look at consolidation, things that have never really been discussed in depth. It's very important to us, and one comment I heard earlier this evening was, we should also look at legislative term limits, because that way we can control our destiny a little bit in the fact that if we do have at-large voting, district voting, that we give the best and the brightest a chance to run for election, get in there and serve, not make a career out of it, and go on back to their businesses or wherever they came from, so other people with new ideas can help out what we need to do in our growth. But bottom line, what I know is just a little over 2 years ago, March 15th, 2012, the commissioners passed a resolution resolving to implement practices necessary to address the growth issues facing Forsyth County. On the commission was Jim Boff, Patrick Bell, since replaced by Cindy Jones Mills, Todd Levent, Ralph Amos, and Brian Tan. Four members in 2012 out of the five still remain on the commission. And this is taken out of the pages 52-53 of the Forsyth County Comprehensive Plan, and it states the following, and I quote, one, we will continue to ensure that the new existing development and is supported adequately by necessary infrastructure, particularly roads, schools, public safety protection, and wastewater treatment systems. Two, we will ensure the new development does not cause a decline in existing levels of service for the community's residents and employers. Three, we will support the local school board and encourage school location decisions that sustain the community's overall growth and development plans. And four, another quote, the Forsyth County Board of Education will continue to provide quality education programs and facilities to the citizens of the county. Now, to me, when you have this a little over 2 years ago, and we see how the traffic has gotten worse, the quality of life of getting home, this resolution is not reality. All I ask is we are open to discussion on the things that we need to change so this becomes reality, which were resolved by the Board of Commissioners 2.5 years ago. Thank you.
The question up here says, what changes do you support on the County Commission that have made? First one is no change. Second one is all commissioners elect countywide. Fourth one, the third one is based on district and countywide. And the last one is city county consolidation.
I'm Brent Meadows. Thank you, Senator Williams. I'm going to take 1 minute of my time. Jack, you did a great job over there explaining about county and city consolidation. But this past Sunday, there's one other person I want to recognize in this room here. This past Sunday, Common Cause gave Georgia Citizen of the Year Award to the lady behind the camera, Ms. Nydia. Locally lacking all the way from Washington down to the lowest levels. And so I applaud Common Cause for that award and what they have done. I am a proponent of city and county consolidation, but let me say something, and especially based off the results up here, whatever happens, I support a change. What we currently have, I believe, is broke and it doesn't work. The city of Sharon Springs and their efforts to make this happen. They brought to the table something that probably would have never happened if it hadn't been for the city of Sharon Springs. And Jack, as you pointed out, it is the city of Cumming. It is all roads cross through the city of Cumming, and you gave a great historical perspective on some of the control that the city of Cumming has. Local option sales tax splits, special local option sales tax splits, are a phenomenal windfall for the city of Cumming. They get a phenomenal amount of money in that first year that they got their local option sales tax split. They got three times their previous year's annual budget. Per person, the city of Cumming, if you look at their total budget, divide out those 5,000 people, they spend over $5,000 per person in the city of Cumming. Forsyth County, less than $500 per person. You tell me who's efficient. The city of Cumming is spending money per person akin to what you might find in Boston, Massachusetts. That's not what I'm looking for. And the reason for city and county consolidation, in my mind, is to lower our taxes, is to save money. Former Commissioner Bowen made mention that it's probably impossible. And Commissioner Bowen, you may be very well true. But if we are ever, ever, ever going to consider city-county consolidation, now is the time. Once we have other cities in the county, it is a virtual impossibility. Richmond, Savannah has done it. Columbus, Muskogee County. I believe Athens, Clark County. So it is viable for us to do that. But the duplication of services is where the big savings is. It's estimated that our taxes could be reduced by 25% by the reduction of the duplications that you have at all levels of the government with the city of Cumming and Forsyth County. So you have one water department, you have one administration, you have one human resources department. And so ultimately, for me, I'm looking at a conservative standpoint, and our state delegation, Republican majority, very conservative. I like the idea of less government, spending less, lowering our taxes, and I think city-county consolidation is a great step in that. But again, whatever the decision is, I'll support any other decision. I support the city of Sharon Springs. I support additional commission districts. What I don't support is keeping it the way that it is now. Thank you.
Paul Floyd, up to speak again. Kristin Stevens, where's Kristin Stevens? You want to come up here?
Better. Excuse me for getting up here the second time. I thought when I was signing that roster, I was signing that I was here. But one thing I would like to say on the organization, and again, I'm for really going back to the way we voted a few years ago, I think in 07, 8, 9, and going back to when I first came up here 40 years ago, that we ought to have one governor, one countywide governor. That means no Sharon Springs and the city consolidation. And in that one government of county commissioners, we could keep the five county commissioners and then add the mayor of Cummings. We could add him as a county commissioner and maybe one other person. But the key thing that I think is that each of the county commissioners should run at large for, they should run for the whole county and everybody in the county vote, but that they ought to live in the district that they represent. In other words, if somebody lives, wants to run for the county commission and they want to run from District 3, they ought to live in District 3, but they ought to run and everybody vote in all of the districts. And that way you won't get parochial and be for something in the city of Cumming or something in around Lake Lanier or in Sharon Springs, but you've got to look at what's in the best interest of the total county. And yet you would still have an extra little bit of interest in the district that you're from. And I think if you did that, again, as I said earlier, you would then look at what is in the best economic, cultural, and environmental interest and advantages of the total county. So that's fundamentally what my thought on organization would be.
Thank you. I know we have four city county consolidation. I don't have anyone signed up to speak against city county consolidation. Anybody like to speak against city county consolidation? All right. Kristin, are you ready? We're going to talk about changing the model of electing our board of commissioners. And first up, Kristin Stevens.
Hi, as you said, I'm Kristin Stevens, and I don't know if all of you or any of you have heard of Forsyth, the HOA and homeowners, but I am one of the founding members. If you would like to find more information out about us, you can find us on forsythhoa.org. Sorry, I don't have a podium. I wanted to say, you know, Paul Flood talked earlier about the fact that we need a plan. We need to know where the commercial should be and where the residential should be. And I 100% agree. We actually do have a county comprehensive plan that is hundreds of pages. It's a great plan, unfortunately, from my perspective and the perspective of a lot of other people who have seen what has been going on over the last few years. That has not been followed, and that is what the problem is, the following of the plan. My first slide, I wanted to show you, basically, this is District 2. District 2 was lucky that we got mostly zoned out earlier, back in the early 90s to mid-90s. And this is the result of that. A lot of neighborhoods that you see with the zoning categories of Res 2, R1R, R2R, CR1, and a lot of those made some great neighborhoods that we all really enjoy right now. If you flip into the next slide, this is the northern part of District 3 and the southern part of District 1. You will see on the slide that there's still quite a lot of green. The green is ag, and that is property that a lot of it has not been zoned out yet. However, this map is not completely up to date. So I'm here to talk to you all because I live in District 2. If you all live over here in District 1 and District 4, or if you're in District 3, you have a lot of problems coming your way if our Board of Commissioners keep voting in zonings the way that they have been doing over the last couple of years. I just wanted to tell you that, again, this map has not been updated. I did want to show you that there has been a zoning that was done by our county commissioners that was put forth by our commission chair, 444 acres with just under 700 homes under an MPD zoning category, which allows for a minimum of 3,000 square foot lot sizes, that did not comply with our comprehensive plan. Going back to District 2, District 2 is what I refer to as being zoned out during the days of Camelot. 400 came in, there was a big boom, but we had these really great zoning categories. Next one. And it resulted in these neighborhoods, Woodland Park, Long Lake, Laurel Springs, Aberdeen. Some of them were golf course communities and others weren't. They did have a variety of lot sizes, and they also had quite a lot of green space versus house mixture. And you can go ahead and scroll through. There's St. Marlow, Glenfield, Old Atlanta Club. These are just examples, Deer Lake, etc. Okay, so the next one, this is an example of what Camelot looked like. This actually happens to be the first house I bought in the county in the mid-90s when my husband and I got married, and this was CR1 neighborhood. And we bought that house for around $138,000. And the next one is a mid-price point neighborhood. This is Old Atlanta Club. It gives you another example of what CR1 looks like. The next slide is the zoning conditions, or the performance standards that our District 2 was mostly zoned out under prior commissioners. And basically what you're seeing here is the lot sizes that were required back then. and that's what made South Forsyth such a great place to live. Despite what one local law firm wants you to think, many of these neighborhoods are on sewer, not on septic. And I also wanted you to know that right after this, back in 2003, we had some commissioners who decided that they were going to fix something that we didn't think was broken. And they went in and changed the zoning standards, and poof, Camelot was over. So what happened next? Okay, so this is what happened. If you look at the peak right here, that was 2006. That was the absolute worst year for zonings in Forsyth County. And what you see at the bottom is, I put this together for a different presentation, but what you see at the bottom is bond and bond and bond, and then we hit a recession. Actually, they put a zoning moratorium on. We had a commissioner who saw what was happening, Charlie Laughinghouse. He made a motion to change the res 3 lot sizes from 9,000 square feet, which is what kicked this off in the first place, down to, up to 14.5, and he got us 3 votes, and that was a wonderful thing. Okay, so basically, we have some commissioners right now who are like to brag that they're doing better than what was done in 2006. And we thank you for that, but I don't think that we should be comparing our performance against the worst year. Maybe looking at what the best year was and striving for that would be what we should expect of citizens in this county. And I also wanted to say that based upon that last thing, which I'd like to go back to, but we actually filled out 2 brand new high schools during that period of recession, 2 high schools. And here we are in a time of explosive growth, and we're expecting 1 new high school in 4 years. So what else happened? Well, this is the topic of the conversation. Back in 2009, as I'm told, there was a stronghold, and this is what the wording was. There were a lot of people who were very naive to what exactly they were voting for at the time. And I believe that this was deliberately worded to dupe the taxpayers into giving up 80% of their voting rights, their voting strength. And a lot of people showed up and they said, well, that sounds good, and they checked yes. And the next thing you know, we're in a situation that we're in right now where we can't vote for all of our commissioners as we used to be able to do. And as I said before, we do have a unified development code and a comprehensive plan. These are what the county commissioners are supposed to be using as guides to zone out our county. During the recession, our planning department took a break and were able to readdress the comprehensive plan and the land use map. They had a new version come out and they voted on it in 2012 on March 18th. And, if you look on the next slide, you'll see that the land use map has a whole bunch of sky blue on it. That was the residential zoning category that the people who approved the land use map wanted to see this county developed as. That is called suburban living. It was supposed to be res 2, which is 18,500 square foot minimum lot sizes, or res 3, which at the time was 14,500 square foot lot sizes. Next slide. But also during the exact same time.
Does anybody mind if we give her a few more minutes to continue the presentation?
No. I appreciate it because I spent a lot of time on this, but I will put this on our website if I don't get a chance to go through the whole thing, forsythha.org. Anyway, during the same time, we had a couple commissioners, Levent and Mills, that were working with the law firm that handles most of the zonings in this county. And they were working with the developer advocacy group to change the standards of the UDC. So basically, they made some changes to allow the houses to be closer together, to drop the lot sizes of Res 3 back down to 10,000 square feet, which is what caused the problem, one of the things that caused the problem in 2006. So here we were going backwards again, right after the comprehensive plan was approved. Here they go into the Unified Development Code, which gives all the standards by which the comprehensive plan is governed. I don't know the right word for that. And they went in and changed the standards, lessened the standards. And I wasn't even really aware about that until like a month or two ago, and I've been at this for a long time. Next one. So these are the changes that were made, and this is basically on the internet where I found it, and it's basically thanking all of the people who went in and made the changes that we are enjoying today. Next one. So now what? Okay, so this is a table that my group has been keeping up. These are all the zonings that were done in 2013. And I put, again, there's a lot of information up here, but if you look, Res 4, Res 4, Res 4, Res 6, a lot of those zonings were not in compliance with the land use map. Those are lot sizes that are about 8,000 square feet minimum, and if you look at what an acre is, it's 43,560. So almost everything that was done in 2013 was on lots that were, let's just say, didn't have a lot of variety of sizes. If you, and also a lot of these zonings that were done were awarded variances to reduce side yard setbacks even further, rear setbacks even further, front yard setbacks even further, on many, many of these zonings. The next one is what has been approved already in 2014. Again, the 10,000 square foot lot sizes is a big theme here. Very little Res 2, which was what the people who made the land use map updates wanted to see. And you'll see, we basically had some improvements, but it was a lot more of the same, especially when you compare it to R1R and CR1 and all those great zoning categories we used to have. The next one is what's in the hopper right now. I will just let you take a look at it. It's still more of the same, more. The next one is, you know, this is you again in districts 1 and 3. This is the green that you're looking at that hasn't been zoned mostly. Some of it has been. But I do want you to know that all five commissioners are going to be voting on what's going to go on here, all five. And take it from our experience, you are going to want to be able to vote in or out all five commissioners, not just the one who represents you in the district. Don't think that these votes are coming down 2-3, 3-2. They're not. A lot of those zonings that I just showed you were 5-0. Some were 4-1. And this is the reason why we're voting for SPLOST after SPLOST, and bond after bond, and our schools are still packed, and our roads are still packed, and we can't pull ourselves out. The next slide. This is what it looks like when you're getting ready to build a Res 4 development. They don't leave a tree. The next slide is what a Res 4 development looks like. And that is the light blue that I showed you on the land use map. That is what's going in on every little piece of light blue on that map. That is that and Res 3, which is 2,000 square feet bigger, minimum lot size. That's what you're getting. That's what you're going to get. The next one is, basically my conclusions. Is this the way we're going to be fixing this problem? More and more of the same. So I appreciate your time, and like I said, hopefully by tomorrow afternoon, you want to see.
Good evening, everybody. My name is Jim Compton. I'm a 20-year resident of Forsyth County. I'm here tonight to speak in favor of returning the county, the election model for electing commissioners back to countywide voting. I moved here 20 years ago from Gwinnett County. When I moved here, I've lived here for 20 years on Post Road. There were 5 subdivisions and the speed limit was 55 miles an hour. Now it seems like there's 55 subdivisions, and it doesn't matter what the speed limit is, because you can't drive it anyway. In the instance of full disclosure, I want you to know that for the last 8 years, I've been a leader of one of the homeowner coalition groups out here, Post Road Committee for Proper Development. It's a 14-year-old group. I joined it in 2003. I think it's done a lot of good work. The reason why I'm mentioning that is because we started hearing about the initiative to change the voting model back in 2007. It was on the ballot in 2008, but we started getting wind of it in 2007. When we did, we realized immediately that it was not something that we wanted. So we're very excited that it has now come back on the table for public discussion, because we've been hammering away at this for 7 years. I've written many articles about it explaining why we should return back to countywide voting. We've talked to anybody that would listen, you know, about why it needs to happen. I agree with what Kristin said, the way the question was worded. We think it was questionable. That's all I'll say about it. But we're very excited again to have this come back up. So why do we want to do this? Well, there is a political term that I probably am unaware of. I made up my own. I call it political localization. What I mean by that concept is, if you look at a map and if you look at where you live, and if you start zooming in geographically to where you live, you reach a point where there's a threshold that you should elect the politicians in your local area. We think and we believe that that threshold is at the county level. Basically, in short, zooming in on district voting is going in one click too far. We just simply need to go back one click and to return it to county level. Nothing wrong with having five districts and five commissioners. That's fine. We just need to change the election model. Why do we want to do this? Well, let's take a look at what comes out of your pocket and your time on a county level. Let's start with finances. Property rates and millage, county level. Local option sales tax, county level. Special purpose local option sales tax, county level. School bond, county level. Ridiculous transportation bond, county level. Upcoming recreation bond, county level. You see the pattern? County level. Let's talk about schools. They're county schools. Yes, they have school districts, but they're still classified as county schools. Let's look at drive time in the roads. Rarely do you get in your car and stay within your district. Now, almost anywhere you go within in this county, in just a few minutes, you're crossing district lines. You go to Lowe's and Home Depot, you're crossing into another district. You take your kids to Liberty Middle School, Liberty Elementary School, you're crossing into another district. My point is, so much of your money and so much of your time and the roads that you travel cross district lines. So therefore, the proper voting model should be county level, because it is a proper representation at the appropriate level. I'll say it again, proper representation at the appropriate level. You're electing commissioners who are the decision makers that disperse that money that's taken from you on a county level. So therefore, you should have the right to vote for all of those commissioners, because again, proper representation at the appropriate level. The second thing I'll say that has already been touched on, so I won't spend much time on it, is the physical, literal reality that we deal with every day with the gridlock traffic, the severely overcrowded schools, and the other burden on our infrastructure. It's unacceptable. Our group has been hammered away so long that, you know, we truly feel that we need to return to county-wide elections, electing commissioners at large. It's already proven to have worked. In the elections of 2006 and the elections of 2008, that put into place a majority of what I would call controlled growth commissioners. It has worked. We need to return it back to county-wide voting so that the majority of the residents of this county are properly represented at the appropriate level. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Jim. Hey, do we have anybody that wants to talk about keeping the current model of voting for the county commissioners the same? Anyone wants to talk in favor of it? Yes. So the Board of Commissioners. Well, that is all we have signed up for speaking tonight. Again, I want to thank you.
May I speak?
Oh, sure. Ms. Tisdale would like to speak for a moment, too.
Thank you, Senator Elect Michael Williams. I was not intending to speak, but because Grant Meadows introduced me, I thought it would be appropriate for me to come and greet you as well. And I actually come bearing gifts tonight. I have these little red booklets called A Citizen's Guide to Open Government, and it's the sunshine. a sunshine proponent. It goes over the Open Meetings Act and the Open Reference Act, which was updated on April 17, 2012, and Governor Nathan Deal signed the law, and it went into effect immediately upon his signature. I also have my calling cards in the back on a little table next to the door as you walk out. Help yourself to both a little book and my calling card. I have a website called aboutforsyth.com, and I have a Twitter account and a YouTube channel and a Facebook page by the same name, and I am a citizen journalist, and I recently published a video, I call my videos, videos, on my YouTube channel called Bullies, Lies, and Videotape, a journey to citizen journalism. And it spans 5 years, and it's a collection of 30 excerpts of videos, and it runs 90 minutes long, and it explains my journey into this booklet and how I got involved with local government. And I would love to share that with you. So thank you very much for allowing me to speak. Goodbye.
Thank you, Nydia. And I also thank you, all of you, for coming out tonight. I hope you learned something. I hope this is the time. Yes, sir?
Can I ask you a question?
Sure.
Yes.
Well,
how the hell are you trying to sell you something? They usually give you a spiel. And then your next question is, if you're interested, how do I apply? What do I do next? I'm going to ask you the same question. You brought up a number of issues tonight, especially with reference to at-large voting.
Yes.
What do we do next?
Yeah. Okay.
We're gonna walk out of here.
Again, well, like I mentioned, we have there's four state delegations tonight that would love to talk to you about it. We have also four of our board of commissioners here who would love to talk to you. Reach out to your members, board of commission, and us. I mean, you've got to stay active. Mike, Geoff, you guys have anything else to add to that? I know we have the commission, Sharon Springs Alliance, that's going to come out. We're going to stay informed, or we're going to keep you guys informed what's going on. And we'll probably have additional town hall meetings coming up once that comes out. Just to stay active, stay informed.
I have an addendum to my question.
Okay.
When, in your opinion, would you feel that this would wind up getting on the ballot? 2016? That's the earliest time?
And how?
What is this?
Those questions.
The questions about the change of the at-large versus the individual district vote.
My understanding, and correct me if I'm wrong here, that question that was up there was not binding. Not binding whatsoever. So there never has to be a question on the ballot to change the way we vote for a board commission.
But you still have to have a venue to vote.
Yes,
I'll throw it over to
you. Scary to think I'm a senior delegation member now. The way it works is the county commission voting structure and pay are certain things that are not home rule. They are controlled exclusively by the state legislature. That ballot question 2008 was put on there to get a pulse of the people, but it really had no binding effect. The law was passed by the General Assembly of Georgia, that when you have local legislation, which only affects one county, only the legislators in that county are involved in the decision. The rest of the legislature gives those delegation members essentially an acclamation vote on something that they agree on. So it boils down, if you don't like the county commission structure, really, it's your state representatives in this forum of the seven who are in the room. You have to ultimately make that decision to file a bill and get it to the General Assembly. And so really, I mean, I'm putting myself under the gun. It's us who are under the gun for that decision. But there's no need for a ballot question. There's no actual mechanism for a ballot question to decide that issue. That is legislation from the state. From the city, if the city moves forward, it is not only legislation, but then it does become, by the Constitution, a vote of the people in the city to form a city. So that's the process for a city. That's at least a couple of years away by the time there's a lot of different hoops in that area. City consolidation, the process is also law to delegation of General Assembly passed, and then a vote of the city by themselves, and a vote of the county by themselves, and both the city would have to approve it and the county would have to approve it. Again, that is in the Georgia Constitution. So to recap, just to change the voting model from the county commission, that's just the law of the General Assembly. The city is a law of the General Assembly plus a vote of the people. City-county consolidation is a law plus two different votes with the city population in the county. So that's your process.
So again, to go back to your original question, what to do next, any of your neighbors or friends that you don't see here tonight, make them aware of what you learned and then have them reach out to your elected officials.
If that process takes forever, get politicians to be what they are.
And what's the tipping?
What is our avenue as far as recall is concerned? Can we recall commissions as a resident of the county? Can we just get enough votes to recall commissioners?
Not as long as you
can't do that.
And in 2 years, you could vote for three more commissioners.
See, that's the whole point. That's why we want to shoot it down. We, because of the fact that with some very strange wording, the voting was changed so that we can't vote outside our district now, we can't get enough of an impact to get the vote changed at that level, and it has to go to your level for us to be able to change it so that we can have that voting structure back to at the county level.
Yes. Again, let me reiterate, there are four of the seven county commissioners here tonight that have listened to this and have heard all this. We need to get our delegation together, and y'all need to reach out to all the members of the delegation and let them know your problems and your concerns.
So we should send emails to you or whatever.
Emails, phone calls, faxes, tweets, texts.
What's the tipping point? Is there a petition that you need? Is there a size of a citizen's delegation? What's the benchmark for you to say, I'm going to sponsor this legislation in the General Assembly to change the voting structure? Or is there one?
So you have a benchmark?
Yeah.
You're saying there's four of you guys here. We could all go talk to four guys here.
Four out of seven, that's the point.
Nothing's happened. That's why we want to know, what can we do today to get that started? Can we write it up, sign it, hand it to one of you four guys and say, we'll add another 5,000 people if that'll help you out.
I'm going to turn it over to our chief.
Just to be clear, there are five House members, of which three are in the room, myself as a Duncan, Representative-elect Cantrell. There are two other House members, Representative Hamilton and Representative Tanner, those five. They have to agree. And in the Senate, we have Senator Lev Williams, we have Senator Gooch, there's only two. The only way you get a majority in the Senate is to get both senators. So in practicality, you have to have both senators and three of the House members. But from a reality point of view, you really want closer to a full-on majority in order to get a more of a supermajority to get things through the General Assembly. It's hard if you have a split delegation. So each of us have different districts and different opinions. And I will also say, you talk about whatever, you don't like us, we get elected every 2 years, unlike the commission. So if you don't like the delegation of what we're doing, we do have to stay in election every 2 years. So it really is, you have to convince each member of the delegation, or the vast majority of them, only seven, that your idea is the right thing to do. And Mike, that's one reason why we're having this meeting, is to hear what people are saying.
Mike Dudgeon, what if, to bring balance to the board, the existing Forsyth County Board of Commissioners today, if there were two members could be added that were elected at large?
Any change is all the same process. As any change, you can make 15 commissioners, you can make a sole commissioner, you can make them elected by district, you can make them elected in the lottery. All that is all the same exact process, which is that this delegation of the General Assembly, which you're looking at some of us here, we would have to sponsor that legislation. It's all the same process.
The target lies therein.
I just put the bullseye on me, I'll just give you. And my friends here are just going to the bus.
Is there another channel, though? I mean, it's clearly a fraudulent question, right? So why don't you take this to the judiciary?
I mean, again, that question is no binding. Does it matter?
No binding at all.
That doesn't matter what the question said or says. No. There's no impact.
No, sir. It's
not binding, but we're bound by it.
Yeah.
We're not bound because of that question. We're bound because of what was passed at the state legislature.
Okay. In 2008, they passed a bill in the Georgia legislature, which was signed by Governor Perdue. It's the law of the state of Georgia. And that law says we're electing commissioners by district. That is the only thing that matters.
So this is that's ballot statewide.
Was only information.
All counties, not just statewide.
No, just no, Forsyth County.
Just Forsyth County.
And that's my point. The local.
Sends in the back and just a
right. Yeah. If Savannah goes and decides to change their city council, the representatives in Savannah will decide that they like that and introduce a bill, and it goes on a consent calendar. And as long as they sign the bill, I'm not going to interfere with what Savannah wants to do with their local politics. It's the same thing as Forsyth County. We've got all kinds of commission models. We've got sole commissioners. We've got seven commissioners. We've got district. We've got county. A lot of different counties. Anyway, but it's really boils down to the seven representatives for your county that are in the state legislature are really the people who have the bullseye on it. And the only thing that matters is not that ballot question. It was the law passed, and it passed and was signed by the governor. That's the only thing that really binds. Bob?
Two-part question related. First part, were the members of the state delegation that are not here this evening, were they invited to be here this evening? And did they attend the other two town halls that we've had prior to this one?
I cannot speak if they were invited to other ones. I know I invited every one of the members here. Representative Hamilton and Senator Gooch are at a transportation meeting tonight. So that's why they were not.
Can I invite on the panel to have surgery before we're about to time of life for the meeting?
All right, any other questions?
We're at their mercy, the way I'm hearing it. And I would like to hear, is there any way they could say they've heard us tonight?
Well, thank you. That kind of leads into how I'd like to kind of end this. Is with all three of these town hall meetings that we've had, feedback that we've gotten from almost all of them is the citizens of Forsyth County would like to have a town hall meeting sponsored by our board of commissioners. So I want to invite our board of commissioners. We want to hear you. Thank you all for coming, and have a safe night in the garden.
Thank you.